Hey everybody, Pastor Greg is here again, and I'm so happy to be here with you. We are celebrating something amazing today. It's resurrection, it's awakening, it's rebirth, it's the birth of spring. We celebrate this symbol, we celebrate this because it has something to do about each and every one of us. If you don't know what that is, I hope that you will continue to listen to this message today as we bring a powerful Easter message. On behalf of myself and Pastor Yolanda, I also want to thank you all for your love and your well wishes and for attending and just showing us so much gratitude and appreciation on the second anniversary of CSC. We have so many wonderful and amazing things happening. If you don't already know, we launched and officially our website went live last Sunday. And so if you haven't had a chance to check it out, please go to www.celebrationsc.org. Again, we are celebrating Easter today. We're celebrating rebirth. Let's get into the message. Rest in that eternal truth. Rest in that eternal truth. And say amen. For those that don't know, here at CSC, at the end of each prayer, we always say, amen. What does amen mean? It is so. Then we say, ashe. It definitely will be so. Oh my God. And so it is. It makes your prayer so much more powerful as you add those multipliers, those qualifiers, that whatever I say, it is so. Whatever I say, it definitely will be so. Whatever I say, and so it is, and so it must be. Good morning, Celebration Spiritual Center.
Good morning.
How's everybody feeling?
Good.
Happy Easter. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Happy Awakening. Happy Rebirth. Happy Renewal. Happy Spring. So Pastor Yolanda has already given us the synopsis of our message series this month, The Lotus and the Lily. We're talking about Jesus and Buddha. And this is a topic that's near and dear to my heart. And I hope that you will learn a lot as we move forward in this month. So as it is Easter Sunday, I recognize that we have a problem. We have a big problem here because it's Easter Sunday. Because what I recognize that because it's Easter Sunday, there's a lot of things that are being celebrated. There's a lot of things that are going on. There are a lot of people that are celebrating Jesus today. There are a lot of people that are celebrating salvation today. They're celebrating the power of the blood of the Lamb. There are people all over the world today that are celebrating Jesus' superiority and our inferiority. And that's the problem about today. Because, see, what I've come to understand is that if you accept the literal story, if you accept the story as it may have been given to you as you grew up, then you're actually celebrating and embracing your own limitlessness. Right? You're celebrating the fact that you're limited. You're celebrating the fact that you're unworthy, although we just sang that we are worthy. Right? The Jesus story, as it's accepted by many on this day, is I am unworthy. He didn't have to do it, but he did. Right? We're celebrating, many are celebrating their unworthiness. Many are celebrating not being enough. Who and what I am is not enough to be valid in the eyes of God, but someone, some man, thousands of years ago had to be violently killed in order for me to now matter. We have a problem today.
Yes.
We have a problem. Because what I understand here at CSC, we just got finished teaching a message, a series on A Course in Miracles. And A Course in Miracles says some very radical things. It says things like, I am as God created me. It says that who and what you are cannot be altered or changed in the eyes of God, that you're holy, that you're beauty, that you're worthy, that you're perfect and complete. It can't be changed. You remain as God created you. A Course in Miracles says that your sinlessness is guaranteed by God. Just guaranteed. You didn't need any animal to be sacrificed or a human being to be sacrificed in order to be good with God, right? This, the Course in Miracles says that you are the Son of God. You are the Son of God. Everything that we've attributed to Jesus, the Christ, as the Son of God is absolutely true for each and every one of you. It says that my holiness is my salvation. Another way of saying that is, because of who I am, I save myself. Because of the power, the beauty, the grandeur, the amazingness that I am, because I am created, I am as God created me, that's my own salvation. Yes. I don't need anyone to stand in proxy for me. I don't need anyone to advocate for me. as it is taught in many circles. And then finally, it also says that my salvation comes from me. Again, that I don't need anybody to get up on a cross for me to be good with God. So again, I say we have a problem. And it's not really a new problem. As I was thinking and preparing for this message, it took me back to one of my favorite teachers, Joseph Campbell. And we'll probably use a lot of Joseph Campbell this month. And the thing that I love that Joseph Campbell, when he talks about this problem, he talks about the split that is taking place in the Western mind. That what we have is sort of a spiritual schizophrenia going on within our minds. And it's not necessarily our fault. What I love to think about, if we look at the universal truth from the Kabbalion, the principle of correspondence, as above, so below, as below, so above, as within, so without, as without, so within. What's interesting is that this very split, we see it in our own world as well as it's in our mind, because it's a split between the Western world and the Eastern world, right? Interestingly enough, we were choosing this month to bring the Western thought and the Eastern thought together, to bring Buddha and Jesus together, who some would say are diametrically opposed, but again, I say that they're spiritual brothers, right? And so what's interesting is that though we, again, have not had pure or frequent access to the Eastern mind here in the West. It's still very new. It's still very recent when we think about, you know, the sages that have come in from India and the ideas and the thoughts that have come, and more people are embracing the ideas and teachings of Buddha. We recognize that this is still new. What's interesting is that we're taught, again, as Jesus must be our proxy, that Jesus was true God and true man. That's the Western idea. And there was some other person outside of us that was true God and true man. The East teaches that we are all true God and true man, or true human being, that there's no split, that your divinity is never lost, right? And there wasn't just one man, one person that walked the earth 2,000 years ago, was the only person that had this ability or could tap into that reality, right? But that is absolutely true for each and every one of us. And the Eastern mind has no qualms with that. The Eastern mind has no trouble with recognizing that, yes, we are human beings in this human experience, and we enjoy and live life according to the human experience, and yet we know we transcend that. Yet we know that we have this divinity that lives within us. We have access to it. And so when I talk about the split, what we understand is that the Western story, or the literal understanding of the Jesus story, is really a story of separation. And of course, this comes from, if we start with the story of Adam and Eve, and that story is what sets up the need and the reason for Jesus to die for our sins. And so I was reminded here of what Joseph Campbell writes about this. He writes, "If you presuppose that you and God are separate from each other, if you interpret atonement as meaning, I have offended God and am now atoned with him, then you are reading this motif as a kind of pedagogical nursery story. And those two cherubim are actual angels, but they're to keep you out." This is the two cherubim, if you know the Garden of Eden story, when Adam and Eve are sent out of the garden, right? They can't go back in because there's a cherubim that's placed where? At the east, with the flaming sword. Now, I was going to wait to talk about this, but it's important to talk about it now. This is important, right? Why was there a cherubim, something that was blocking Adam and Eve from the east? Well, we know that they ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. They ate of the tree of duality. They ate of the tree which no longer allowed them to recognize that they were both human and divine. Because remember, God created them in its likeness and image. Let us make man in our likeness and image, right? They no longer recognized their divinity, and because of that, because they stepped into that place of duality, they could no longer be in the place of paradise. They could no longer be in the eternal place. They could no longer be where the tree of life was. They could no longer live in the east. They were blocked from the east, and now they can only live in that Western world. They can only live in that logical world. They can only live in that analytical world. They can only live in that reasoning world. So again, Joseph Campbell says, and so if you believe that those two cherubim are actual angels put there to keep you out, right, then you're believing it as though it was a nursery story. But if you interpret those angels as simply aspects of your own sentiments, as desire and loathing or desire and fear, then you realize you are being kept out of the garden by your own sentiments or by your own thoughts. Yes. Right? And this is why I say that this story today, it is really about you. And what we love to talk about here at CSC is that we're not interested in the literalism of these stories, because that's not what it's about. That's the Western mind, again, the logical, literal way, right? That's taken us to a certain point, but it's allowed us to believe that we're unworthy. It's allowed us to believe that we're limited. It's allowed us to believe that we don't have power. I'm here to tell you that you have power. I'm here to tell you that you're unlimited. And so we must look at the symbols. We must understand the symbols. And by understanding the symbols, we understand ourselves. I'm remembering of the great comedic teacher here in Brooklyn, Ra'un Nefer Amin. Right? He says that I don't, people ask him sometimes, you know, do you believe the Bible? He said, I don't believe the Bible, I understand the Bible. Yes. See, there's a difference, right? There's a big difference. We're not here to talk about believing the Bible, but we are breaking down the symbols so that we understand it, so that then we can live a more powerful life. So I've already touched on a part of this. We have three stories, but there's one symbol. The first story is the story of Adam and Eve. The second story is the story of Jesus and the cross and the crucifixion. And then the third story is the story of Buddha and his enlightenment. And today is the day that is actually celebrated as the day that Buddha achieved enlightenment, sitting under the Bodhi tree. So we have this topic, the cross and the Bodhi tree. Now, again, we know the Garden of Eden story, right? We know that there was this story, what was important and central to the story was this idea of two trees. There was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and there was the tree of life. And after Adam and Eve ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, it was said that we have to push them out of the garden, because if they eat of the tree of life, they will become like us. They will truly become God, and they must be blocked out, right? And what's interesting about those trees, first of all, the trees, again, as we're talking about duality and as we're talking about separation, there was really only one tree. That the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was a symbolic tree to represent when we move through life, as we come into life, as we're birthed through life, right? We come into this place of duality. That's the only reason why the so-called fall came through a woman or a female. Not because Eve was bad or sinful, as it's interpreted. It's just we all come to life into this place of duality through a woman, yes, yes? That's all that story was symbolizing. It was not symbolizing that there's something bad about Eve, that there's something bad about women. But recognizing the symbolic nature of what this story was trying to tell, we come into this place of opposites, we come into this place of duality through a woman, the most mysterious, powerful being on the earth in my eyes, right? You all bring life, right? You all are in touch with a realm that I will never be in touch with. It's awesome, right? So let's just know that, hear that. Eve, women, the feminine aspect, there's nothing evil about that. But we recognize that it came through her, because that's how we come into this place of opposites. But we recognize that, again, these trees really symbolize one idea, that behind this place of opposites, that if we transcend the place of opposites, again, it was said, if Adam and Eve ate of the other tree, then they would become like God. They would have transcended this world, which is what we want to do, which is our opportunity. Now, we go on. We have the Jesus story. And again, today is Easter. Now, we know the Jesus story for the most part, right? Of course, there's the miracle of Christmas and the manger and all of that. We won't talk about that. But we know that once he came of age, the story and the beginning of his ministry really starts with this fasting, the fasting of 40 days and 40 nights. He was tempted by Satan or the devil or the adversary, right? And of course, we know he overcomes that. He wasn't tempted. And then we have this wonderful moment where he's baptized by his cousin, John the Baptist. And it's a beautiful moment because a dove descends, and it's said that that dove is God. And the dove or God says, this is my son, my beloved, in whom I am well pleased. Of course, we move through and Jesus performs many miracles and many wonderful things. But ultimately, he is betrayed. This is the Piscean story, right? This can be seen and told over and over again. We talked last week how Dionysus is the same as Jesus. Horus is the same as Jesus. If you want to look at the story between Isis and Osiris, it's the same story, right? And part of the reason of that is because all of these stories were symbolizing the path of the sun, right? And so as we've come back into spring, we're coming into the awakening, into the resurrection of the sun, where there will be more light, right? And as we follow the story, if you follow the story along, when we get to summer, that represents the time of the transfiguration and where Jesus ultimately rises back into heaven and gives that great command to the disciples. That's the sun at its height. And so we have this wonderful Piscean story of the betrayal and being falsely accused and crucified and, of course, raised from the dead. But what's interesting is that this cross is symbolized, it's really another tree. And this time, although it's a violent symbol, and it's been used many times, this crucifixion within different stories, different dying and resurrecting saviors, that this motif has been used over and over again. What we see here is that Jesus actually represents the fruit. Because it's really at this point that we can now call Jesus the Christ. And the Christ being the fruit, if we eat of that fruit, then we will become like God, the same tree of life, the same thing. If you understand who and what you are as the Christ, and we're going to talk a little bit more about what that means. If you understand who and what you are as the Christ, if you eat of that fruit, if you taste of that fruit, if you take that into yourself, into your consciousness, then you will indeed be free. Then you will experience heaven on earth. And so then we have the third story about a man named Siddhartha Gautama. And do we know the story of Buddha? How many people know his story? I love his story. And one of the things that I love about his story for me and why this series is kind of near and dear to my heart, when I was in seminary, I was challenged beyond belief. And there were a lot of things that I thought I believed to be true that were completely knocked to the wayside. I learned to see and read the Bible differently, right? I had to reject certain interpretations that had been a part of my life. And once I traveled through that journey, many times I liken it to Neo taking the red pill. And, you know, at one point, you know, in The Matrix, Neo says to Morpheus, "Why do my eyes hurt?" And he says, "Because you've never used them before," right? And that's what it felt like for me. I would hold the Bible in my lap and just have tears in my eyes because I was like, I have never used these eyes before. And what began to happen for me and what really became the larger shift or the larger watershed moment for me was as I began to release certain ideas and certain beliefs about Jesus and about the Bible and about God and about myself, I said, well, if this is the case, then there must be some more truth going on out here. And I was immediately led by the Spirit to look at the words and the teachings of Buddha. And it was like I was reading an old friend. And definitely like I was reading or rereading the words of Jesus. Now, if you want to do some deeper study, it is said that and thought by many that Jesus is the reincarnation of Buddha. That was something that was prophesied amongst many Buddhist circles. And so if you study, you'll find that there are stories and teachings about a man named Saint Issa, I-S-S-A. And it is said that these teachings in this time marks the time, there's a gap in the Bible, right, where we don't know where Jesus was, right, before he sort of starts his ministry. And it's said that these writings and teachings by and about Saint Issa represents the time that Jesus went to the East. Because what I understand to be true is that Jesus couldn't have been as bad as he was, except he spent some time in the East. He actually could not have done the things that he did, except he had spent some time in the East. You couldn't get that knowledge anywhere else. And there's many wonderful stories, we can't tell it all, but he got kicked out of India because he spoke out against the caste system and people didn't like that. But Jesus was being Jesus, right? And then, of course, then Jesus comes back home and we have the rest of the story. So that's for your deeper study, right? So this story of Siddhartha is interesting because he was born royal. He was born a prince, destined to become a king. His life was amazing and perfect, and he knew nothing of suffering or being in lack. But there was one day where he encounters suffering for the first time. He didn't know that there were people were poor. He didn't know that there were people in need. He didn't know that there were people suffering. And he was arrested by this moment because he looked at his own life and looked at the life of others and said, something's not right here. I need to understand what's going on. I need to understand what the meaning of life is. And he rejects his royal life, completely rejects it, and goes on this quest. to understand, to find enlightenment. And what's interesting to me, one, I love the symbol because it represents for me the idea that when we come into this world, first of all, we come from perfection, right? We come from wholeness. We come from royalty. But when we come into this place of duality again, then we come in touch with the contrast, as Abraham would say, right? We come in contact with the rich and the poor, with the having and not having. We come in contact with the pain and with the joy, right? The pain and the ecstasy. We come in contact with it, and then we're trying to live our lives trying to figure out what this thing is all about, right? And many times we do that by trying to prove our worthiness, right? And this is essentially what Siddhartha did. He went on this ascetic journey and began to do all of these crazy things to try to prove that he was spiritual and prove his love for God, you know. And this time you would do things like, you know, laying on a bed of nails, and that was the way that you showed that you were super spiritual, you know. But in this day and age and times, we do things that we think are spiritual, trying to prove our divinity. But you don't have to do anything. I don't care if you never light a candle, if you don't have some special ritual. You don't need all of that, because God is not looking for that. If you remain as God created you, your very holiness is your salvation. You are your own salvation. You don't have to do anything to be right with God. Just breathe that in for a second. Breathe that in for a second, right? And so the story of Buddha represents that doing, going out and doing, trying to prove, trying to make everything a test, making everything a lesson. It's not necessary. Right? How can you improve on perfection? It's not necessary. Can you add any more wholeness to wholeness? It's not necessary. And of course, represented in the life of Siddhartha, we see that he came to that recognition, that he was trying to do all of these things instead of realizing that he only had to be. Yes. Because we are human beings, not human doings. And so we come to this beautiful place where he now goes within. He sits at the Bodhi tree and he goes within. He meditates for days upon days. Now, what's interesting to me is then we get a familiar story. Because while Siddhartha is sitting there in meditation, he's tempted by Mara, another symbol for the adversary, Satan. There's so many different symbolisms for that. He's tempted yet again, almost in the same way that Jesus was. Is that by coincidence? That we would have the very same story, this very same story of temptation. And of course, Buddha overcomes the temptation. And it's said, depending on which version of the story you read, that he touches his finger on the earth. And ultimately, that was at the last test, and he overcomes the temptations of Mara. And then it says that, similarly again, at this point, after that conquering of temptation, we have this, these beautiful words. This is Sakyamuni, my beloved son, who through his 500 incarnations has so given himself that there is no more I. Jesus, it was, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased, the dove descends. Again, this is my beloved son, whom through 500 incarnations, has given himself that there is no more I. And then it goes on and it says, as the morning star rose, he became Buddha, the enlightened one. Jesus is also called the bright and morning star. Is it a coincidence that the enlightenment of Buddha takes place as the morning star rises in spring, just as the resurrection of the Christ takes place as the morning star rises into spring? Of course not. But what's interesting to think about, again, because this day is not about these men, whether they actually lived or not. I'm not here to prove or disprove that one way or the other. What I think is important to recognize is that Buddha's name isn't Buddha. That the Christ or Jesus's name is not Christ. These were titles, right? Buddha means, as Joseph Campbell would say, it just means one who has waked up. This idea that he has recognized that there is no more I, that this I, this physical self that is limited, that will be shed, that we'll get rid of, the soul clothing, as I like to call it, we're going to get rid of it, right? But there is an eternal you that we must come in contact with, that you must come in contact with if you want to know your greatest self, your powerful self. Similarly, Christ, again, is a title. It means anointed one, or a definition that I love that I came across recently was covered in oil. And why do I love that? Because both of these words, both of these images, Buddha and Christ, have everything to do with light, right? The idea of Buddha achieving enlightenment, right? The idea of the Christ being the anointed one covered in oil, I think we talked about this last week. Why is that oil symbolism important? Well, because at that time, oil is what was used for lamps, right? You couldn't have light without oil, right? So you recognize that if you're covered in oil, there's a guarantee that light will be there, right? If you're covered in oil, there's a guarantee. So we have this idea of enlightenment. It is time for us, again, not to worship Buddha, not to worship Jesus, but to now take on this title for ourselves, because the Christ lives within you. The Buddha lives within you. You are the one who has waked up. You are the one that is covered in oil. You are the one that is full of light. Let your light shine. This time in the world simply symbolizes that, simply celebrates the light that is within you. That's why we naturally get excited when spring starts to come. We naturally get excited when the days get longer. We naturally get excited that today is a 60-something degree day. It's reminding you about you, your own light, your own Christ consciousness. Last week, we talked about let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. Let this light be in you that was also in Buddha. Let this light be in you that was also in the Christ. But recognize that your name is the Christ. Can you just say that to yourself? I am the Christ. That's not sacrilegious. That's not blasphemous. It's one of the most powerful things you can say. I am the Christ. Another way to say it, I am the light. Yes. Right? I am the one who has waked up. I am the one that's aware that I am more than this physical world that I see. I am the one that's aware that this body, yes, this body I will cast down, but I will pick up another one. I recognize that I'm eternal. I recognize that I was here before and I'll be here again. You're unlimited. The point that you start to realize that, oh my God, the things that you can do in this world. The things that you can do in this world. One of my favorite analogies, I thought about it as I was sitting earlier. I love to think about video games in this place, right? Because what I love about video games is we can completely identify with the character, right? As we're playing the game, we think that we're Mario, right? And if Mario falls or gets hit, we're like, oh, right? We identify, and it's fun to really get involved with that character. But yet, you're also aware that there's an eternal you behind the controller, behind the screen, that is not being hurt, that is not being harmed, that you're fine, that you're not falling into the fire, that you actually didn't really get burned up, that the monster didn't eat you or kill you. Like, you know all of that. You also know that you have multiple lives. You know that you can restart the game. You know you can start it over. You know that there's special codes to have unlimited lives if you want. This is the same truth. That's a microcosm for the macro truth of who and what you are. You're behind the game. You're the one that's at the controls. There's an eternal you that's behind all of this. Yes. When you learn and understand that, when you embrace that and begin to live your life from that place, again, oh my God, the things that you will begin to create. What is fear at that point?
Yes.
Right? What is fear? This is why A Course in Miracles says there's nothing to fear. Because it's pointing you back to your self, capital S self. So with all of this, why are we celebrating? Right? I mean, why even identify with this day? I mean, on one level, I'm sure many people could take this message and say, yeah, well, this is why I don't fool with any of that spiritual stuff. Right? I mean, seriously, like why even deal with this? Why even talk about Jesus? Why even bother opening up the 66 books known as the Bible? Like, why? It doesn't make sense. And I want to say that this message and what we're talking about here is not it's not even an embrace of humanism, although I love humanism, right? It's not just an embrace of, oh, we're great as human beings and that's enough, right? Because we transcend humanism, right? This spiritual idea that we're talking about transcends that. Humanism gets us so far, but we got to go beyond that. And it's definitely not a celebration of atheism, because I'm just not identifying with a God with a white beard up in the sky that's judging us. I'm identifying with the God that is within each and every one of you, that connects us all, that is everything, and is good and only good. We're just being clear about where God is.
Yes.
That's all. But what are we celebrating? We are celebrating the end of division. We are celebrating the end of separation. We're celebrating the end of us versus them. This is why the resurrection of the Christ is so powerful. Because as Jesus gave up that body and resurrects into glory, glory again, glory, it points to light and the sun, again, resurrects into glory, we recognize that we have that same ability. We recognize and we celebrate the end of man versus woman. We celebrate the end of humans versus nature. We celebrate the end of black versus white, or gay versus straight, or young versus old, whatever you want to talk about. It's the end of division and taking us back to unity.
Yes.
Taking us back to oneness. And I think this is important. I think this is important, and we have to understand this, because, again, as I say, we're eternal. We're neither male nor female. We're neither gay nor straight. We're neither young nor old. We're eternal beings. And so often in this life, we get hung up with whomever we are. Yes, I'm African American. I can't change that. That's what I chose to be in this life, right? Yes, you may be gay or straight. That's who you are. You can't change that. Thank God, that's who you are, and we love you as you are, but recognize that beyond even that, it's something more powerful. It's something greater, right? It's something that's unlimited. It's something that is one. You are both male and female, right? You are both gay and straight, if you want to say that, right? We recognize that there's something beyond even any of the identifications in this world, and the celebration of the Christ, the celebration of the enlightenment, the celebration of the one who was waked up is the one that knows that. Because that's where your power is. When you know that this world has a lot of categories, right? Beautiful categories. This world has a lot of contrasts. It has a lot of preferences. It has a lot of ways of being. And that's what makes this world so awesome. But beyond that, there's the stillness. Beyond that, there's the peace that will remain. Beyond that is an ease that will remain. Beyond that is a joy that can remain no matter what the circumstance is. This is the wisdom behind an often misused verse, "I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me." If you look before the verse, Paul is saying, "I've been rich, I've been poor, I've had and I've not had. But what I recognize is that no matter what, there's something behind it. I can do all things, I can endure, I can be and remain at ease and at peace no matter what's going on, because the light, the Christ is within me." Oh my God. That is the truth of that verse. So today we celebrate, and I just want to leave you with this last lesson, which is actually the lesson for today in A Course in Miracles. And it says, so appropriately, "I am one self united with my Creator." It is a celebration of this reality, that we are one self. It's a celebration, and what I love that The Course in Miracles talks about often, it's a celebration of our restoration to sanity. As we started out in the beginning, we talked about the spiritual schizophrenia. We talked about this idea that there's a split between the East and the West. There's a split between the right brain and the left brain. And unfortunately, the analytical, the logical brain may have taken over. It has allowed us to believe a limited, literal story that tells you nothing about yourself. But when we turn ourselves back to sanity, when we restore ourselves back to sanity, we now unite both halves, because it's not about a war of the East and West, but it's about a uniting of the East and West. One self with our Creator. When we understand and come to that place, we become like the Christ. When we come back to that place and understand, we have eaten of the tree of life. We have given up the knowledge of good and evil, understanding that this is how it plays out in this world. But that's not the whole story. That is not the whole story. And so we are united as one self, restored back to sanity. We have gotten rid of the spiritual schizophrenia. There's no longer a war. We are no longer forgotten who and what we are. There is no longer an angel at the east blocking us from being in eternity, from being in paradise, from being and having and doing whatever we want. Are you ready to live and embrace your light today?
Yes.
Are you ready to live and embrace the Christ within you today?
Yes.
Because this is what we're celebrating. I invite everybody to stand. This is what we're celebrating today. We are not celebrating a man named Jesus or a man named Siddhartha, aka Buddha. We are celebrating a present living reality within each and every one of us. And yes, it's reflected in the fact that the beautiful colors come out of the ground in springtime, celebrating. Let heaven and nature sing, right? Yes, we celebrate this time because the sun is reminding us of who and what we are. As the sun, the light of the sun becomes more powerful and stronger and moves closer and closer into its glory, into its height. That is our glory. That is our height. And thank God for the eternal reminder that we don't even have to do anything to be reminded of it. We just have to look up. Just check the calendar. And you can see your glory. You can see your greatness. Just look at the calendar. Look at what nature is saying. The birds get it. Right? The trees get it. It's time for each and every one of us to get it. And so in this moment, Mother, Father, God, we stand in complete awareness of our Christ nature, of our Buddha nature. We stand in complete awareness today that we are the ones who have waked up. We are the ones that are covered in oil. We are the ones that are full of oil, anointed, and ready to be light here in this earth. We are grateful for the restoration back to sanity. We are grateful for the restoration back to sanity, that we have moved now into a place of unity and oneness. For we recognize that the death of Jesus was a representation of the death of all of those false, illusionary ideas of who and what we are. That represented the idea of the death that we are unworthy. It represents the idea of the death that we are limited. It represents the death that we have no power. It represents the death that we can be betrayed. Oh my God. Oh my God, there's no one doing anything to us. And the Jesus story proves that to us. I don't care what is going on in your life here and right now. There is no one that can betray you. There is no one that can speak anything over your life that will keep you down. Because the truth of your life is that you are eternal. The truth of your life is that you are unlimited. The truth of your life is that you are powerful. And we are grateful for the symbol of the Jesus story that shows us that very thing. No, there is not a number or amount of lies that can be told about us to keep us where they would rather us be. Oh my God, I'm grateful for that symbol. Nothing can keep us from realizing and living and being who and what we are, for we remain as God created us. And so we put our eyes on that eternal truth. We put ourselves back in the garden because we recognize that the story is a story that we have created within our own minds with our own thoughts. And so with our own minds and our own thoughts, we gladly tell the angels, you can go about your business now. We gladly allow ourselves to live in the east side as well as in the west side. We gladly allow ourselves to live in a place of harmony, to live in a place of unity, to live in a place of balance. And to live in a place where we are in the world, but not of the world. To live in a place where we experience all that is amazing and powerful and beautiful and delicious about this world. But we know still that it is limited and it's not the whole picture. It's not the whole story. We use the idea of even our past lives only to inform our eternal nature. We know that even the story of the past life has no bearing on the present. Because we create from the here and now. And so whatever it is that we are deciding to be or do or have, we shall be, we shall do it, and we shall have it. I speak a word of blessing over each and every one of these Christs in the room. Each and every one of these lights in the room. I am knowing with them now that there is an outrageous courage that is bubbling up within them even now to live life on a grander scale. Yes. To live beyond their fears. I see it and I feel it now, and I know that each and every Christ here in the room will begin to live as their resurrected self, will begin to live from this day forward and from their awakened self, will begin to live from this day forward from their reborn selves, no longer living from the shell of limited life and limited thoughts, no longer living from the shell of being unworthy, no longer living from the shell of somebody's talking about me, no longer living from the shell of somebody is doing something to me, no longer living in the shell of unforgiveness. We stand in that same place that again Jesus stood in. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. And we live free. Not in prison and putting no one else in prison. I am grateful for the ways in which we will express our Christ nature, our Christ consciousness, our Buddha nature, our Buddha consciousness here on the earth throughout this week and for the rest of our lives. The earth is singing in joy, and we are singing right along with it. For these words, we are so very grateful. We release them now with expectation. And together we say with power, amen.
Ashe.
And so it is.
And so it is.
Thank you, God.